make a go Igbo. I see my girls in Njeko. All over the world, even Echo. Yeah, your baby, your wedding, I see go take photo. Your birthday, I see go take photo. I see my girls in Njeko.
My name is Clement Eze. I'm from Ezike, small, tiny village Ezike, in Isialambano, a local government of Imo State. I reside here in Edison, New Jersey, a graduate of New Jersey Institute of Technology in Newark, New Jersey, as well as NYU School of Professional Management in Real Estate. And currently just about almost done with Stanford University, where I'm also involved in the advanced professional management. We came from somewhere. I believe it is important that we inculcate in our children the sense of belonging, the cultural identity. In this case, a lot of them are seeking for that cultural identity by going to things that appear to be African. When actually the real African culture, we can showcase that before them in real life. I remember the first time when my kids went to Nigeria, they were running around chasing chicken. And then their grandmother brought the chicken over and said, they said, we're going to kill the chicken. They said, no, grandma, don't kill the chicken. It's not supposed to do that. And my daughter wound up almost being sick because grandma had to chop the chicken head off. And that was traumatic. But that's part of the culture. Kids really see chickens being killed here. So they see it in the supermarkets when it's already dead, packaged, and we eat it. But when they get to see how the chicken can actually become one that they saw here in the supermarket, killed and defeathered, and then maybe ready to prepare them as a dish, it was traumatic for them, for her, and then she was having that difficulty. Let's not take it for granted that the reason why many of us don't take the children home is not because they're not willing. You can only do as much as you can afford to. If you have 5 children here, you may take turns to take them to Nigeria. But just think about it. Each trip that you take a wife and kid, a wife, a husband, and 3, perhaps upwards of up to 4 kids, that's about 6 of them traveling to Nigeria. It costs you nothing less than $20,000. That's between the flight tickets to some other arrangements, security-wise, making the place comfortable for them to be able to stay and then come back here. How many people can afford that luxury? And that's what I call it. It's a necessity in one sense, but it's also a luxury in terms of affordability. How many people can afford that on a continual annual basis? They do it every 2 years, they do it every 3 years, or they do it annually. Can you afford it? If you can afford it, you have a place to take them to, and then you refuse to do that, then, well, Lord be good, I don't even know what would be the reason why you should not do it. To answer your earlier question, yes, it is important. The kids need, our children need to have that sense of belonging. Nigerians have had a great measure of success. But actually, we're participating in a society that has already been built. And of course, a society that will continue to require some moderations in rebuilding. Nigerians have done well. I would say, you know, we have my good friend, Honorable Elia Tisibo, almost won the Senate, the last dispensation, when he ran along with Murphy on the same Murphy ticket line. We have Charles Ake, Chief Charles Ake, who was also a very strong member of the Murphy campaign, that is Phil Murphy, for the governorship of New Jersey. Born in Lifeland, though, was actually actively involved in the mayor of East Orange, and then he then went on to deliver that. On my own level, on my own instance, and I think, I see my own politics as transactional. I'm an investor in politics, and I watch the candidates, and I see if there is something for my people to gain from that. It may not necessarily be me. So long as somebody from Nigerian community will benefit from it, then I think that's step number one, we check that off. we as Nigerians can invest in that. Then number two, the person or persons that benefit from that, will they now open the door for other Nigerians? Then I say, fine, we will also check off on that. And the reason why these two primarily are very important for me, as you know, to the extent that my participation really matters, is because we don't want to spend our own hard-earned money in investing in the politics of electing a candidate. Then one of us, our people within the community, benefits as a result of the hard work in votes, in canvassing, in monetary contribution, and not open the door for the other folks. To me, I think that would be the excellent thing to do, in the sense that it closes the door for everyone. Even the people giving them the positions or the jobs, they will start to see then that they are myopic in their thinking. We need to broaden. We need to open up the space for more participation. That's what I have been able to advocate time and time again. So I'm not shy of investing in politics, and I will continue to encourage Nigerians that no matter how much money you have, it can be wiped out by one policy of the elected officials. But if you are part of that discussion, you can avoid that from happening. That's what lobbyists do. They don't want their wealth to be wiped out overnight. That's why they hire lobbyists to go and lobby the congressmen and women to make sure that the policies that come out from the lawmakers, they don't wipe out all of their investments. And I think we as Africans can equally do the same thing. I'm glad that, you know, most recently that there have been so many agitation, the election of our current president, Donald Trump, has really energized people from all across, white, black, Nigerians, Africans in general, especially when we began to be called these not so pleasant names, and which I will refuse to dignify by even mentioning. But I think it sends the message that we as a people have now come to understand that even our presence here, it does matter. Some people feel threatened that Nigerians in particular are making so much progress, but we have to take advantage of that and continue to march and hit the pavement and make the noise even more. One door will open and more people will begin to walk through that door. But whoever walks through that door, do not close the door behind you. Leave it open, let the opportunity continue to flow. Even when one of us or many of us make the mistake of not opening the door, we should be a constant reminder. Keep the door open, keep the honesty rolling, keep the opportunities open to everyone, as many people as want it, deserve it, and are willing to work hard to take advantage of it. My feeling for the IC magazine, you know, the first time when I heard about it, I kind of shrugged my shoulders. I hope it's not another one of those big ideas that eventually got morphed into something that goes nowhere. But I think if I recall the conversation that I had with Jonathan, you know, Loco, Sam Loco, he said, Clem, you will like this idea. And then he began to explain the concept. So my first reaction was, this is something like Ovation, meaning the magazine part. I didn't know that there was a TV part, so it looks to me like you have the entire media, if you will, the print magazine, the media, television, and who knows how many more things that you're rolling into it. But I would rather not see this as a venture that just ends only here in the North Jersey, in the Jersey area. I think it should be really expanded in the diaspora. Are we talking about in the diaspora here in the United States, or are we looking beyond the United States as far as going to Canada, going to UK, and many other countries? And one thing I've come to appreciate about media is that whatever media organization that gets out the news first and gets it right is always the one to be believed. So if you are slow in getting the message out, I see it the way you see it, you record it, and then let other people decide. If you were slow in seeing it, and you were slow in reporting it, then you may want to rethink about your organization strategy. If you have enough resources in terms of personnel and correspondence to get you those juicy news, and then you get the message out there, and people are watching, people are reading it, then you become a trusted name in the delivery of the news. The traditional news as we know it is beginning to disappear now. And of course, there will still, some of the major ones will still hang around, but if you notice, the internet has taken over some of this medium. You're getting messages faster from here now, from Nigeria to here. It's just a matter of a click away. When you talk about the gossip, when I hear gossip, I have come to associate gossip with people who just talk about things that didn't happen, people who want to besmirch other people for things that never happened, may not happen. So I'm believing that it will be gossip in the sense that it has been redefined. Again, depends on what you mean by gossip. If it is to get a message out there, what you heard, and it's verifiable, it's true, nobody is going to fight and argue about that. But people's reputation cannot overnight be destroyed in the name of gossip. That is also gossip. So we have to pick and choose, be very careful what we're gossiping about, how we're delivering that message out there, and who is behind it. So long as your organization, meaning the IC magazine and the TV or conglomerate, so long as you guys have reputable individuals that stand with the integrity to deliver the message, they're reporting what they saw, and if it is verifiable and it's on time, no one is going to fight it because facts are stubborn. We're entitled to our own opinions, as someone ever said, but not to our own set of facts. If you're reporting that, no one will have any argument about that.